coming this evening. We're really glad to have you at, what is this, our third special event here of our evening seminar series for people of Queen Anne's County and surrounding areas who would like to learn about aviation, cool and exciting things that happen in Cape Verde Airport and in the surrounding areas. Probably one of the coolest and most exciting things that we have going on here happens to be Deputy Bill Schepleng and the Gyroplane program that the Sheriff's Department runs. He is going to be telling you all about the program and how it works, and even give you an opportunity this evening to see the Gyroplane out here on the ramp. So without further ado, thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Helen. If anyone has any questions, stop me anytime. This is very relaxed, and I just have a couple things that I'll bring to you of what the aviation does for Queen Anne's County. I started flying when I was 41. I started driving up to Frederick right after, in 2001. And I got my private license in 2001 in rotorcraft, 2004 my commercial rating, and 2007 my instrument rating. I started on my own time, my own money. At the time I was working for Anne Arundel, and they let me use the car, but I got qualified in helicopters and never thought I'd fly professionally or for work. I retired from Anne Arundel in 2009. And did a couple things. I still live in Pasadena, but 2011 I came here and fell into this. They didn't have a pilot at the time, and this aircraft was here. How we got this aircraft is I'm just fortunate. 2010, the Department of Justice was doing a test program. They were trying to figure out low-cost aerial platform for smaller departments. Anne Arundel, we had a Bell 407 that was $2.2 million when they bought it. It's probably worth $3 million now. Training for a week of training in Bell down in Texas is $13,000. So for a small department like Queen Anne's to be able to have an aerial platform would be extremely expensive. Department of Justice tried powered parachute, a couple of small aircraft, light sports, and one of the things they tried was an Auto-Gyro. It's made by the company Auto-Gyro. The model that we have is called the MTO Sport. It's an open cockpit. Auto-Gyro is made is a company from Germany, and there's three models: an open cockpit tandem, closed cockpit tandem, and then a side-by-side. This test program, we were fortunate, was done here at Bay Bridge Airport. DOJ, Department of Justice in DC, and the gentleman running the program lives right here in Queen Anne's. So Chesapeake Sport Pilot back then and Auto-Gyro did a lot of promotions here for the program. Other people from all over the United States came here to see some of the test programs. And I just came to Queen Anne's in 2011 and fell into it. They were looking for inexpensive aerial platform that the helicopter is expensive. Anne Arundel's, I've heard quoted, is like $500 an hour just to operate. The new Maryland State Police helicopter, the Gustav Westland's 139, which is a wonderful aircraft, crew of four. They do a lot, but it's $4,200 an hour to operate. I'm not sure if that's the people and all, but you know, they're flying IFR, they're doing a lot. And it's a very modern aircraft where the pilots are more systems management. So it's it isn't what I fly. But for me, this inexpensive thing, I do all the things that wouldn't be cost effective for them to do. When I came here in 2011, I started flying it. I learned how to fly it. I have at this time, I only have a sport pilot's license because there's no FAA examiners around. So I'm able to fly this. 2012, there was a test program in-
You say sport pilot license, you mean only for this category, right?
Yes. Yeah. I have a commercial instrument for helicopters and a sport pilot for airplanes. But in 2012, this was packed up with another Auto-Gyro and was sent out to California. I spent 2 weeks in Point Magoo Naval Air Station. It's about an hour above LA, and we were out there. It was a test program. There was a lot of UAVs there, and I think they wouldn't tell us that it was mostly to see if they could see us. But I was fortunate, the U.S. Justice Department took me out there. That aircraft, I flew off the coast of California, and it was a wonderful experience. Also, that was kind of like in the later part of 2012. Before that, we did an operation called Black Dart. It was stationed here in D.C., Bay Bridge Airport. We went into D.C. We had certain GPS points into D.C. We had special squawks, everything. This was a coordinated through several federal agencies and the FAA, and it was a multitude of them, where they wanted us to fly into D.C. and do a known course, known speed, known altitude, and see if they could see us or follow us. That was about a week-long project that we flew out of here. Some of the days I had to fly that aircraft to Manassas, which is about an hour flight, go up the Potomac and right around D.C. and back, talking to ATC the whole time to see if they could see me. So 2012, we did that. I'll go into what we do now, but as of 2014, the test program was over. The feds have moved on to something else, I guess, and they signed this over to us. So the citizens of Queen Anne's got a free aircraft. And fortunately, when I came here, I already had my ratings. I had about $40,000 invested in my ratings. So they got that too, which is, I'm fortunate that I fell into this. And 2014, we turned over to us. So now we exclusively fly it. It's kept here at the airport. The sheriff's office has a hangar. We have a Zodiac, and the aircraft are kept in that. So we're real fortunate to be able to stay here at the airport. Auto-Gyro is here. They sell these and repair these and do all the mechanical work here. So I'm very fortunate also to have my mechanic here if I ever have problems, and my instructors here. So questions or anything like that, I'm extremely fortunate to have all that right here where I don't have to make a phone call or anything like that when I have issues. Just this year, well, just last year, 2015, in March, we had the sheriff's office had an eviction of a 10,000 square foot house. It was just north here, and I don't know if it made the news or not. It was a sovereign citizen who had gone through all the legal process and was finally evicted. Well, he was in jail at the time for a crime. He assaulted on an officer. He got 2 years. But the eviction, we were worried that it was going to go bad. He made threats. So during the day it was going to happen, they kind of knew it. I flew with the entry team as the team drove up to effect the eviction. We orbited, and we were able to see five guys on the bay side that they didn't even know about. And so the aircraft's starting, or might start, I'm trying to start incorporating in any tactical operations. Search warrants or anything like that, we would go with them and give them an aerial view.
Doesn't that make you kind of a sitting duck as a target?
I've been asked that.
It's not an issue.
Of course it's an issue. But that day I had, my observer was one of the narcotics people, and he said, what's gonna happen if they start shooting at us? I said, I'm out of here. Mm-hmm. PG County Police Department, I know, have found bullet holes in their rotors. So it is a threat that I'm aware of, and it's, I think it would be a little hard. I normally orbit at like 800 feet and maybe 50 knots. And so that would be a toughie, I think, to hit. But it is a concern. Last June, I was fortunate the National Sheriff's Association was in Baltimore. And I did take the aircraft up there and was able to represent Queen Anne's at the convention center up in Baltimore. It just happened to be here. And then I think it was August, the U.S. Air Force was here. One of the projects I was involved in, but the aircraft wasn't, is it was called Falcon Virgo. It was an operation from the U.S. Air Force that was rather involved. It all worked out of here. The four-star admiral from NORAD, was here. Everybody was in plain clothes, but I found out this guy, I looked him up. This is the head guy of NORAD, and he's the one that had to testify before Congress for the gentleman that flew into the Capitol with the lawn chair with a leaf blower motor on top. I got a lot of grief about that, too. Everybody said it was me. What we did is, on a Sunday morning, we flew a one aircraft, one autogyro, one small airplane, one autogyro, one airplane north and one south, and we proceeded into DC at a low altitude. We had our transponders turned off. There was an F-15 over top that we were talking to make sure they could handle communications for us, but also to see if they could see us. And then the aircraft I was in, we came from the north. We went all the way into the Mormon Tabernacle and turned around and came out at 500 feet. And I think they did see some of us, but also what they wanted to see if anyone would call 911. And I think they got one out of all four aircraft. So that's something they're looking at. But it's one of the programs I was fortunate to be involved in. And last year, the autogyro we flew about 60 hours last year. And some of the projects that we do law enforcement searches and a lot of photographs. Just this Monday, I flew about 3.5 hours, a little bit more than that. We took photographs of all the schools in the county. And what we did is we're going to be making a icon for all the officers' computers, say schools. They'll be able to punch it up on their computer and have aerial photographs of every school in the county. So I've already, actually that's what I was doing today. I'll have files for every school, Graysonville Elementary, on and on, and we have about 12 to 20 photographs of each school. So the officers on the ground, the officers are gonna be responding to it, not just the supervisors. We'll have all these photographs.
So they know the layout of the building?
Yeah, and roads. I did it this time of year. Because
you just depend on images from Google Earth for that.
Because how old are they?
You don't know. Yeah.
These have time states on them, and we have a brand new junior high over here that had portables outside. I remember driving by on 50. Monday when I flew, portables are all gone. I didn't even know it. So that's one of the advantages of, I'll probably do this once a year now, about this time of year for the officers. And that's going to be available to State Police, Centerville Barracks, Centerville Police Department, and the Fire Department, that if they want it. Just one of the programs that we do, some of the people that I've flown for, Animal Control, I've flown the girls from Animal Control several times for different horse farms that they're looking at or investigating for cruelty. I've flown for the State's Attorney's Office for many photographs and taken animal control for the state's attorney's office. There's a horse farm up by the 4-H park that they took like 100 and some horses away a couple years ago that were sick. The lady still lives there. She does have horses, and the state's attorney's office wanted to know what condition the horses were in. So we went up and took photographs of it for them.
How is something like that funded? Is that, the cost of that come out of the sheriff's department, or is that by whatever organization is getting you to do the work?
The funding for the aircraft is mostly seized funds, but the aircraft is paid for. Mm-hmm. The hangar.
I mean, for the operation time and for your salary while you're flying it.
At this time, I only do this part time.
Okay.
I do 2 days a week here at the airport or flying or schedule my flying. 2 days a week, I work the courthouse at Centerville in uniform.
Okay.
So they get me for half my time is at the courthouse helping out.
Yeah, I was just trying to figure out if the state's attorneys
want
to take pictures of something, do they cover the cost of that, or does that come out?
The aircraft costs less than $50 an hour to operate. Mm-hmm. I'll show everybody later. It burns 5 gallons an hour and holds 19 gallons. But the biggest determinant on how long I can fly is how long I can sit in it. After about 2 hours, it gets a little old. And I'll show you later, we have a brand new motor This aircraft has about 500 hours on it, a little bit more than 500. About a year and a half ago, we had some seized money. It was grant money from the state. And what we're able to do is the motor on it now is a 914 turbocharged Rotex. I did have on it a 912 carbureted, which is about 100 horses. Fortunately, that motor was running great, had 400 hours on it, 450. They were able to use it in an airplane. So I was able to sell it, and the grant money was able to afford a brand new motor for the aircraft, and we've moved up to a turbocharged Rotex, which pumps out 115 horses. The biggest advantage with the bigger motor, when I take off, makes my takeoffs a little shorter, especially if I got a lot of fuel and a heavy set person in the back. It makes my takeoffs a little shorter. And when I'm doing photo work and I'm orbiting, a lot of times if I'm losing a little altitude and I need to, I can just hit the throttle and get out of the hole, as one would say, if I have any issues of losing altitude a little too much. Monday was windy. A lot of the orbits I did around the school, of course, I'm going down the racetrack and then fighting my way back and gaining altitude, then fighting. And I don't even think my observer noticed it. But, you know, I'd lose like 50 feet on one leg and then bring it back up. But we use it a lot for photographs. Just last week, I took photographs. I took one of the guys up and we worked at Route 50 and 213. There was a five-person fatal there last year. And the state's attorney's office is prosecuting the driver of the truck. And Lance Richardson, good friend of mine, I asked him, I saw him at court, and I said, would you like photographs? He says, yeah. This is kind of what we produce. This is a attempted murder case that was a jury trial. The shooting was here. The suspect parked his car back here, came through the woods. I was involved in the jury trial. It was a very high profile case for the county. And the detective that was involved in it, I took up. Whenever I take people up, I'd rather take the person, the investigator up, to get his photographs, not having it through another person. So the detective was with me and he was able to get his photographs. This was used for a jury trial, and what it was, they were able to say, okay, he walked here, he did this. The whole time they're hearing this trial was a three-day trial. They're hearing about trailer, they're hearing about a church, and this made it so much better. The state's attorney was able to show of what, give it more meaning to the jury. The ones I took the other day of 213 and 50 right by the college, if it does go to jury trial, Lance already has on his computer maybe 20 photographs I made of the intersection. In the county, we have two facilities that can print these out. One's emergency management, the other one's zoning and planning. So all I do is take my memory stick to them. They've been wonderful. They print this out for me, and I take this to my customer, as you would say. So we provide this service a lot. In 2015, I fly a lot for narcotics. They get information on a grow or something like that, and I'll take the detective up and he'll do photographs. I take him up a lot, and I never write down where I go because I don't know where his investigation is, so they can trust me. But last year we found 3 grow operations and made 4 arrests from finding the grows in the county. And especially, I think it's fall is when you can go along the fields and all of a sudden in the middle of a cornfield there's like a little green area. And I don't know if that's always, I've seen some and I'm always wrong, but it's really obvious. And fortunately, 2 of the narcotics officers are trained in that. So we use that for eradication also. But they'll get...
So they can just go by what it looks like, not by spectral analysis?
They take photographs. They take photographs and then zoom in on it. They got a special camera, and with this, I'm able to get in like 500 feet, nice and close. And normally, they'll get information. They'll be given information that, hey, somebody's growing something. And instead of driving or around, we just fly for it. And we'll take care of that. zoning and planning, I've done a lot of photographs for them. I hate to say it, certain people in the county have some zoning problems, and I'll take care of that, and that's been a lot of help. But other agencies, over the continuing flights I normally do, like every year, is narcotics. Twice a year I go to Wacomico County and help them out with Pork in the Park and Bike Week. I go down to Salisbury and help them out. The portable I'll show you that I have plugged into the aircraft. We have a portable that's into the aircraft so my observer can talk directly with any agency. And we had the Marine channels programmed on it too. Monday, I was telling some other people that I flew for about 3.5 hours, did all the schools. We came around, downwind was on the other side of Route 50, came over top of the Bay Bridge, came in on final. It's a little windy, crosswind, I'm fighting it. I'm, you know, paying attention to what I'm doing. And my observer goes, "I see a body." I said, "Say what?" I may have said something else, but I said, "Say what?" And he says, "I see a body." I said, "Hold on." And I had to get on the radio, abort my landing, come around, and we found a body. And it was actually a jumper from Sunday. So fortunately, we had the radio right in the aircraft. My observer was able to call Queen Anne's. Queen Anne's called DNR. We were hanging around for a while. We didn't know how long DNR. We came down to get some gear.
You mean like a parachutist?
No, we get jumpers off the Bay Bridge all the time.
Oh.
Yeah, they don't publicize it. But it is a problem. And evidently Sunday there was one. And it was the body was right off the runway. So we were just coming in, and sooner or later I knew we would find things like that. I've done searches for suicidal subjects. We had a young man up in Roosburg once that disappeared in the woods, and they found him a couple days later with a dog, but we searched a lot for that. Evidently he was underneath a tree. And I asked a detective, I said, you know, because I was interested, we couldn't find him. He said, no way you would have ever seen him. He was underneath a tree. So,
do anything with infrared to?
No, we do all daytime operations. Yeah. And at this time, we're not doing night ops.
No, I mean, even in daytime, an infrared camera could tell you that there's somebody down there next to a tree or something.
At this time, it was in the wintertime. And the wintertime is the best. When I flew for Anne Arundel, I ran the flare. And in the wintertime, people look like light bulbs in the woods. And especially when their head sticks out of the tree like this and they're looking at you. One of the tricks we used to use is put the searchlight over here. Mm-hmm. The pilot would use it and I'd be flaring over here. Because mm-hmm. then they're thinking you're looking here. It's kind of a game you play too. Some of the skills. But thunder in the narrows, when you have the boat races down here, I'm here, I go up and fly for a while, come down, and we're talking to the boat the whole time, so if they need help. And unfortunately, we had the death last year of the little girl there, and I think it's being canceled this year. They said because of water, maybe?
Water death, but that was not due to the death there.
Yeah. It was terrible. That's when I was up Baltimore with the aircraft at the Sheriff's Association, so I wasn't involved in it. The year before, I was. But it just turned out, and it was a real tragedy. The Bay Bridge run is a big one. I've flown both times for that. Anne Arundel comes in also with their helicopter, and this year they were sat here, and they didn't know what to do. I let them in here, so they were all happy that they were able to begin the pilot's lounge. But they were, of course, we worked together with them, and we're able to do a lot of coverage for the Bay Bridge run. To let them know any problems, especially traffic problems up here when they shut down all those things. And Unity Day is another thing I do every year. Every year the schools, I don't know how you explain it, they put on shirts and they spell stuff out outside. And I've done this, I don't know how many years in a row. We take photographs of it all and give it to one of the directors. But the kids get out, it's anti-bullying. They get out and spell stuff, and actually it's pretty good from the air. We do that also every year. That's about all I can think about. Any other questions? The gyro, there's three of them in the United States that the Justice Department had. One in Texas, and Tomball has one exactly like this. They had a little problem with it and they just got a brand new one. Their sheriff down there is from LAPD. and was very used in aviation unit. When you see the sheriff, please tell him that you were here. The sheriff gets beat up a lot about money. And this is so inexpensive. A lot of people, I try to explain to them how cheap this is for what they get bang for their buck. Yes, sir.
Why do you think there's only three? It sounds like it's a pretty cheap yet effective tool.
I think a lot of departments maybe don't know about it, but every pilot, I have gotten some negative feedback from some other people. A lot of pilots don't want their chiefs to see this. They want their Bell 407, they want their MD 500, and I don't, you know, sure, I'd love to fly a $3 million piece of equipment. But for over here, the sheriff's office is about 60 men and ladies, and it's a smaller department. Finances are a big thing, and this is just gives them the aerial platform for such an inexpensive amount of money.
Quantified. Hey, cheap. What are we talking here? One of these.
Oh, if we bought one?
Yeah.
Depends upon the year. I think 85, 90,000.
Okay.
So it would have been a startup cost of that. The only thing I have is insurance. Maintenance is an annual, yeah, once a year. But see, I'm also public use, so technically I don't need an annual. Technically, I don't need a license. But of course we do. The fuel, 5 gallons an hour. And we worked it up where my police car is more expensive to run than this thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm on call 24 hours a day. I've been called in many times. I don't know if you remember the drowning down here, Miss Pope. I was here that Saturday all day. It was cold that day. And I flew over, not that day, but the whole time looking for her about 6 hours. Yes, sir.
What's your time for when you're tasked with, like, let's say like that, a SAR mission or something from, is it like an hour or two when you're airborne? Is it?
I can get, like I said, I live in Pasadena. Okay. I'm fortunate. They let me take the car home. So I'm used to getting called out for years. I can normally, and when I do get called out, I have a text worked out on my phone. I have about 5 guys that normally fly with me. They have flight suits, they're familiar with the aircraft. 2 are detectives, 1's narcotics, 1's in a specialized unit, and 1 of the other guys. I text them and say, hey, I gotta do this now, who's available? And by the time I'm out of the driveway, somebody's already heading here. So one of my observers will meet me here, and we'll load up like the Pope. The gentleman from narcotics came in that day. He says, yeah, I'll be in. And we flew a lot for that. These guys are used to the aircraft. The big advantage of this aircraft is, and disadvantage, is the open cockpit. Little chilly in the wintertime. For about an hour, it's not bad. I'm fortunate the feds also gave me, like, I have 3 like Carhartt coveralls. I wear a winter flight suit. Let me put that back on. Mittens, the helmet's warm. For about an hour, it's not bad. Longer than that, it gets a little chilly. But the big advantage is my person in the back seat has no obstruction, can see perfectly. For photographs, it works. Monday, when I flew, the first person I used in the morning for the schools, he says, Bill, can we do a left orbit? Because I can hold the camera over here. I said, great. So we started Sudlersville and worked our way down, and he and I were able to get everything from Centerville up, and then the second person came in the afternoon and we did everything from the college down. And it worked out, it was a good day, and it worked out real, and I've got the files now. I think it was like 300 and some photographs we have. And that'll be for the officers. Some of the hurricanes they've had here, or the problems we've had with flooding and all, emergency management would like to go up and do an assessment. I've taken them up. The program is still evolving, and people are still getting used to it and knowing that we're there. Monday, the detective that was with me went over to Hemingway's to meet DNR when they were bringing the body in for Monday. He knew the acting lieutenant there, a good friend of his. The guy was all excited, said, well, that's great you guys found us. He says, listen, anytime you need us, call us. So I'm still trying to get the word out. Maryland State Police have been wonderful. I've done searches with Trooper 4, and the civilian pilots that are working for them now are like, they all want to go for rides. And the way we've done searches with Maryland State Police, if both of us on the scene, I go to like 500 and do an orbit, and they'll go to 1700 and use their flare unit. So we'll both be doing it. We were searching for a suicide subject once. And we're on a common channel, I'm talking to them, and it worked out real well. They've been very, very accommodating, especially coming into their aviation area. But I don't live in this county, but I think that the people here are very fortunate to have this and how it's all falling together. Major Williams, who just retired from the sheriff's office, is a pilot. He was the number two man at the sheriff's office. He was very much involved in this and very much a proponent for this unit that's now started. And I am the unit. I'm the chief pilot, line pilot, safety pilot, mechanic, and they get a lot of bang for their buck.
Are you an A&P?
No. No. I just have a commercial instrument rating for helicopters. Well, I do certain things. Yeah. And certain things, I have the mechanic right here, which I'm very fortunate. The aircraft's very simplistic. I don't have hydraulics. I have pneumatics. But it's not much to go wrong. I know in the Bell 407, we have so many instruments and so much equipment. They get an inspection every Sunday, and it, of course, it's an A&P that does it. But it's such a simplistic aircraft, easy to fly, very forgiving, and flies like a little German sports car, especially in the wintertime. And it's a very growing product.
Is there a time limit on the airframe?
2000.
So once you reach that, then it's junk?
I think it depends on the parts. I haven't even gotten that far. Like I said, I only have 500 hours on it, and I got a brand new motor. But the rotors, 2,000 hours.
Okay.
The frame, it's German made, and it is made very well. The weld, if you look at the frame going up, if you look at the welds, they're really nice.
Is that a 1,200 TBO on the Rotex?
2,000.
I think it's 2,000.
2,000, yeah.
The Rotex, I was very unfamiliar with the Rotex when I came here. And since I've been here, I've flown the light sports that have them. I've learned a lot about them. I've been very impressed. And especially this new motor has been just great.
This doesn't qualify as light sport though, does it?
I think it's experimental or light sport.
It can be flown by, it meets the sport pilot definition. It is sport pilot eligible.
Okay.
The plane is certificated as experimental.
Okay.
But it is light sport eligible, so it can be flown legally by a sport pilot.
What about night flight?
If it is so equipped with lights and things, a private pilot can fly it at night.
Is this one equipped for night?
The only thing is my dash doesn't light up. I've been a little dark, and actually when I was with Anne Arundel, I liked flying at night because you can see other aircraft so much better. But the dash doesn't have lights in it. All I'd have to do is put probably dash lights in. But right now, the searches we do, the missions we do, it really isn't needed. Mm-hmm. And me being the only guy. but I think they're trying to get, they're on the road to getting it certificated. I don't know how long that takes. But it's on the road to being certificated someday.
Deputy, first of all, thank you for your service, sir. Two questions. Would you take this up in, like, last night, there's a lot of geese flying. I mean, every 2 minutes, there's a flock of geese. Would you go up in a night like?
No, maybe not at night. I've met the engineer that put this together from Germany. He's been here. And I met the owner of the company. They're very German. Evidently, a goose would be no problem with this rotor system. It's got enough kinetic energy in it that a goose would be all right. I've had a bird hit me on my shoulder, but I have a windshield plus I have a helmet. It'd probably bounce off. I've had a bird strike in a helicopter. I was in a Bell OH-58 in Annapolis, and one came through the canopy. I was on the controls, and I went left, it went left, I went right, it went right, and a seagull came through the canopy. And fortunately, the pilot put his visor down. I always flew with my visor down. But wind-wise, I've had this in 40 knot winds. And of course it was 40 coming down the runway, but it is a lot easier than a small light airplane. Monday at altitude, I had 25 to 30 knot winds. Yeah, it was a little hard, you know, doing it, but it worked out real well. It flies real well in heavy winds. And my checkout ride, the examiner or the instructor said, okay, it was blowing maybe 30 knots that day. And we went to Love Point, and about 800 feet, he said, okay, pull the power, emergency, you know, procedure. So I nosed it into the wind. I'm doing, how far was it? It was blowing pretty good, about 30. I'm doing about 45, 50, but on the ground I'm doing 15 knots. I could have read a book on the way down. So it auto-rotates. That's basically how I land. And to take off, this aircraft, there's a shaft in the back. It's called a pre-rotor. I line up on the runway. The brake's on. I hit a button, and there's a belt on the back that starts the rotor system up. The rotor system, and then I take the throttle up with the brake still on. About 3,000 I get it to. And I get the rotor system up to 200 RPMs. At 200 RPMs, I tell the person in the back, the stick's coming back. And I've surprised some people. Comes all the way back, full throttle, brake off. We start rolling down the runway. I pop out off about 100 feet or so, stay in ground effect till about 55 knots, then climb out. So that's how my takeoffs are. My landings, I come around, line up, bring it back to about 55 again, 60. When I know I can make the runway, I put it in idle. I come in, I do a flare, just like a normal helicopter auto rotation. I do a flare, come down to almost stop, back, then the front wheel, and then roll out. I have a pneumatic system that I change over to and run it up that stops the rotor. The rotors have to be straight when I'm taxiing. If they're side by side, I can roll over. So I have a little switch, a bypass that I can bring it around if it's real bad. But a lot of times I can just kick the aircraft and the rotor will come around straight.
What do you cruise at?
Most of the time I can cruise at 90 to 95 knots. With the new motor, it's great. But the advantage with this aircraft is I can bring it back to like 10 knots and do a real slow orbit. You can walk it right around. You bring the stick all the way back and it stops. And I can do a real nice slow orbit at 10 knots for the guys that need to do photo work. But
10 knots, wow.
Yeah. Oh, it can, on a good day, if it's blowing, I can stop it.
Well, yeah.
But
you're talking airspeed.
That's correct.
Okay.
And ground speed. Yeah. But it's able, and the rotor system doesn't change. My RPM, when I have somebody in the back, it rotates faster. The other day, Monday, it was 390. Normally when I'm by myself, it's about 360. But even when I go slow, the rotor system stays the same speed. It's very constant.
So it's just the attitude of the...
Yeah, and whatever I'm doing, I've got pedals for a rudder also. And the rudder, of course, operates the front wheel for taxiing. But it's, you know, a lot of times when I'm training and doing things, I'll be on the downwind, I'll bring it all the way back, and I'll just walk along 10 knots, and then I'll dip the nose and pick up my speed. So it's like I said, it's very forgiving. And
do you need to keep track of the rotor speed? How do you control the rotor speed? Is it just your airspeed through the air makes the rotor turn?
Yes.
What?
It's an unpowered rotor system.
Yeah.
So basically, I'm auto-rotating all the time.
Okay.
So let's say all I have is the power to the back motor. It's pushing me along, and I'm orbiting. If I have a power failure, in a helicopter, you got to drop the collector, come back with the cyclic. You got to do a couple things real fast, or you get behind the curve. I know in the Robinson especially, I did training and they said if you get the 58% on the rotor speed, say goodbye.
So you've got a tack for the engine and a tack for the rotor. Then.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
I have several, I have a tack for that. And now I have manifold pressure and RPM. Mm-hmm. And most of the time I'm just watching my manifold pressure. But in this, I'm already auto-rotating. If I have a power failure, I just got to figure out where to land. And that's it.
Yeah.
Is that a constant speed prop?
It's a variable pitch, but I kept hitting the switch, and there's no indicator on it. So we trimmed it out to where it's perfect, and we pulled it. But it is a variable speed prop on that. And if I was flying back and forth from Ocean City, yeah. But for all my missions, I really don't need to trim it out as much. It works just fine. It's one of the little peculiar things about this aircraft. Anybody else?
Yeah, one more question.
Sure.
I work with a major state agency that does shoreline surveys looking for pollution sources on Chesapeake Bay for shellfish protection, namely failing septic systems or pipes or anything like that. Any experience recognizing environmental things in your time in the air, like
When I was with Anne Arundel, they videotaped the whole coast of Anne Arundel periodically. And in environment, people look at it. Like I said, I go for zoning and planning. Also at Anne Arundel, a guy put a 100-foot bulkhead in, added 100 feet to his property, never got a permit. So we took zoning up for that, and they were taking photographs. I mean, it was a really nice job. And then also we flew, if you're familiar with the island in the middle of the Magathy, the guy that built the house there, well, I was putting an addition on my house at the same time, and I live on the water. And it was a real nightmare. And we used to fly over it all the time. It's really a nice looking place. And yeah, he didn't get anything. We did photographs of that too.
Are you interested in building some partnerships to?
I'll fly for anybody. Okay. I'll fly. The more we fly this aircraft, the better.
I'm working with a team out of the University of Maryland. We're trying to look at UAVs or something. Are you also the pilot that does that for the county?
We do not have a UAV.
Oh, you don't?
When I came here, we didn't have it. Evidently, there was some sort of program before I came, and then when I came in 2011, we do not have that. That is, a lot of the citizens are not happy about that, and so that has been not here. I have not been involved in that, and this has worked out so well that.
Great, yeah. It's for the price.
For the price, that's correct, and I think the service we. I fly all over the Eastern Shore. I've flown also for the State Fire Marshal's Office, any law enforcement agency, but a lot for our detectives. A lot of our detectives go. The other week we had a big theft and they were looking at a suspect. We went and flew over their house and took some photographs. So fortunately it's evolving where a lot of the officers and detectives are getting used to it. The offer's been made to state police. The major we have right now was with the state police. And he told his troopers, he said, you guys need any aerial assets, call me. Meaning for like their fatal accidents, for prosecution. I said, just call me, I'll take care of it. Mm-hmm. So no, I work with a lot of agencies. Queen Anne's County Sheriff's Office has been very accommodating with that. And it's just in law enforcement period, they help us with different things, and we help other agencies. So it gives us a lot more work.
You're putting in how many hours in the air here?
As many as possible, but Monday was 3.5. Today I was working with the photographs and I had to get the radios worked on and all. So I am only here 1 to 2 days a week. If they need me at the courthouse, if they're short somebody, I help out there. But, and then I'm on call. My corporal is in charge of the courthouse. I answer to him. And he's been very accommodating. And the sheriff also has been very understanding and very supportive of the aviation.
So you're looking at what, 250 hours, 300 hours a year?
About 60. I did 60 last year. Yeah. Oh. So it's. I think Anne Arundel may have done 100, maybe. They got cut on fuel. But of course, they're a couple $1,000s a year for their fuel, for jet. If there's no more questions, if you want to come outside, I'll answer some questions on the aircraft.
There.
811 Tango X-ray has always been the tail number. Even when we changed the registration from the U.S. Justice Department, it was Rural Development, something from Tennessee, it was U.S. Justice Department. And the registration's changed. As I explained, this is the new motor, the Rotex 914 turbocharged. And this right here is the pre-rotor. It's been running a little cold, that's why I have some aluminum foil over the oil cooler. And we have dual radiators. This fairing was put on. If you notice the photograph that they had in the paper, this is green and these are not there. Behind the seat is, I can pull the seat out, oil reservoir, teetering bolt downstairs to do all the, well, that's what I do my pre-flight. But you can see these welds, aren't they though? Mm-hmm. From Germany. And they're selling like crazy in Europe. Has dual tanks, both of them plastic and see-through, which is real nice. Up front, it, like I said, it's very simplistic. Throttle, brake, choke for the motor, the cyclic. It's kind of like a helicopter, but without a collective.
Hmm? The motor's not injected.
The turbo, yes, I mean it's turbocharged. Yeah. It's not injected, that's correct. Okay. It's not fuel injected.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're coming out with one, but at Oshkosh, Rotex is coming out with a new motor of 135, but they're not putting it in this. I was gonna try to find out how to get one. Like I said up front, there's really not much to it. You can see this is the radio system that we put in the back. That was a real nightmare trying to get wired into the system. And then we had to have a comm box put in also that I have to go, I can go between aviation and police. Fuel gauge. This is the pneumatic system I have. It's blowing up now. It bled off a little bit. It's that piston right there. So it'll go up and shut itself off. As soon as I land, stick is forward. I put on the brake right here to switch between brake and flight. Run the power up and it's just basically a brake right here on the rotor system. That's also my trim. I have trim forward and aft. I don't have it sideways. Normally for training, your instructor sits back here. So that's why I told the guys or ladies back here, this stick comes all the way back and they need to be sitting up when I start out. And a couple of guys have been surprised. But that's it. It's very simplistic, not much to go wrong. A lot of times it's hard for me to get the speed down when I'm coming around. I'm doing like 90, 80 knots, and then when I'm in base, I'm trying to bring the speed back. And especially when I'm losing altitude, she picks up. So the good thing is if I have a wind coming down the runway, I'll nose it right in and bring back my speed, because it's sometimes hard to get that down to 55. But it auto-rotates just like a helicopter, and but without the power. And in an auto-rotation, you don't need the power.
What's the weight?
About 700 pounds.
700.
But it's, you can turn it. If I need to turn it, I can take the brake off and push it around. When I learned to fly airplanes, I thought, yeah, okay, this is a run on landing. Okay, I can do that. But I still think airplane's a lot harder. Helicopter and this is much easier. A lot of places I go, everybody's always asking questions. I've flown in the east, gone by Easton before, and the tower's asking me, well, how much fuel do you burn on that? And I had the instructor in at the time. I said, do you get that a lot? He goes, yeah. So when I go to Salisbury, they ask me about it too. You got a Jesus nut up top, and then you got two more underneath and here. You can see the grease fittings. Every 6 hours, I grease it. You can see the fuel pump there. I have a fuel pump on the other side. When I turn the electric on, I have one fuel pump going, and then I have a switch for the second one.
Thank you, sir.
No problem. Thank you. Working nights, I'm not used to it.
Thank you for showing us.
Take care.